Shalom Aleichem, my friends. I would like to discuss a few words about Parashat Beha'alotcha. Well, I have chosen to speak about the theme of Miriam HaNevi'ah, the prophetess, the sister of Moshe, and the sister of Aharon. Here we find in this parasha that something happened. I mean, Miriam is one of the heroes of the Jewish people. Aharon used to be the prophet of Israel before Moses, before Moshe. And both of them somehow were relating to their brother Moshe, the illustrious Moshe, the master, the king of Israel, the one who spoke with God himself, face to face. And we know that he did marry Zipporah, the daughter of Yitro. He married her, and she grew up finely with him. But in that conversation between Aharon and Miriam, relating to Moshe, Miriam apparently used a certain language that is not proper. Let me read this portion. ותדבר מרים ואהרון במשה על אודות האישה הכושית אשר לקח כי אישה כושית לקח. And Miriam and Aharon began to speak against Moshe על אודות האישה הכושית, because of the Ethiopian woman, or if you prefer, the dark-skinned woman, which is the word for kushit, ki isha kushit lakach, because the woman that Moshe had married was indeed dark-skinned. Well, vayomer, what did they say? Harak ach be Moshe diber Hashem? Now there is here something that is quite bizarre. First, they relate to Zipporah, the wife of Moshe, as though she is a Cushit, which means dark-skinned. They didn't use the name Zipporah. But at the same time, they seem to be coming on her side, saying, why is it that Moshe... Because apparently Moshe, after he spoke with God and he came down from the mountain of Sinai, after he gave the Torah to the Jewish people, well, Moshe became, he was not anymore as human as you might think. Even though he was still a man, but he was so spiritual, much more spiritual than physical. He was practically an angel. When he came down, you remember when the Torah told us, that when he came down, the Jewish people were petrified before him. They could not move because they saw that he had horns of light. So they were afraid to approach him until he himself invited them to come to him. So the Torah tells us, since he was a different person, you know, you speak to God, you don't become different, you think. So he found himself under the obligation to divorce his wife. Not because he had any animosity towards Zipporah, his wife. God forbid. He had to separate from the life of marriage as we know it, because he could not be the man that she would want to have. There are other commentaries on that, but all of them do not say that this is something negative that he did. I am sure that Zipporah herself understood. Even though she came back later, but she did go as divorced, so to speak, to the house of her parents. So now Miriam and Aharon are talking about this. Why is it that he separated himself from his wife? What does he think he is? Is it possible that he did it because he spoke with God? So what? Quoting, Vayomeru harak ach b'Moshe diber Hashem. Why do you think that God spoke only to Moshe? Halo gam banu diber. But God spoke to us also. And we did confirm that she was a prophetess, and Aharon was also a prophet. And then it says, Vayishma Hashem, and God heard this conversation. God was not pleased with that, because apparently, if Moshe would have been present at this time of this discussion, perhaps he would have been offended that they spoke about Moshe in such a way. It's almost vulgar. And therefore, the Torah confirms that Moshe, who had to have a reaction after he heard what was said, since probably God let him know. So it says, "Ve'aish Moshe anav meod." Rather than telling us that Moshe was offended and he reacted with anger or something of the kind, it says here, "And the man Moshe was very humble." The man Moshe was extremely humble. Mikol ha'adam asher al pene ha'adama. He was more modest, more humble than any human being on the face of the earth. Why is it that the Torah is telling me this? Very simple. Moshe did not make a big fuss out of this dialogue between Miriam and Aharon. It was not, rather, it's not a dialogue, because we don't see that Aharon participated in the discussion. He was just standing with her. But of course, the Torah includes them both, because they were both, she is the one who was talking and he was listening. And you know the rule, the law about Lashon Hara, you know, evil talk, evil gossip. There are three people who could be taken, who have to give the account for that. The first one is the one who speaks the evil conversation, the one who says Lashon Hara. The second one is the one who heard it and did not react angrily or did not stop the man who was talking. And there is a third person, a person who accepted, which means he agreed. Now, in which category should we put Aharon in this discussion? Doesn't say anything about it, but Aharon was present there. Did he agree with Miriam? We don't know. Apparently he remained silent, but he is still under Jewish law, and Jewish law forbids even the person who remains silent when he hears something negative about another person, especially when you talk about your own brother. And that's why God became angry. And he found it necessary to punish Miriam. We are not going to see that Aaron was punished, but God was not pleased with him. But Miriam was punished severely in order to teach the generations that they should be careful before they talk bad about anyone. Miriam became a leper for 7 days. But at the same time, we don't forget who she is. Because the Jewish people then, in the wilderness, could not go anywhere. And they all stayed by their millions. They stayed all these 7 days waiting until she is cured after 7 days. That's what the Torah is telling us. First, Hashem calls upon Miriam and Aaron. And then God says to them, how can you speak against Moshe, your brother? Don't you know? He's my servant. Lo chen avdi Moshe b'chol beti ne'eman hu. Wherever he goes, he is my loyal servant. Pe el pe adaber bo, he says to them. God says, I speak with Moshe mouth to mouth, which means face to face. Umar'eh velo bechidot. I show myself to him, not by riddles, like any other prophet. Utmunat Hashem yabit. I have given him the merit to even look at some kind of likeness of me, God says. Umadua lo yeretem ledaber be'avdi be'moshe. Weren't you afraid to talk against my servant Moshe? He did not even say your brother Moshe. Vayichar af Adonai bam vayelach. And God became angry at them and he left. Ve'he'anan sar me'al ha'ohel. At the same time, the smoke that always when God came down to the tabernacle where he invited them to come to him, there was always a cloud of glory that appeared. But this cloud was taken away from the tent where God spoke to them. And suddenly they saw, Ve'ine Miriam metzora'at kashalek. When Aaron turned to Miriam and he saw her that she became leprous. Vayomer Aharon el Moshe bi Adoni. Now Aharon turns to his brother Moshe and he says, Al natashet alenu chatat. Please, my Lord, do not hold a grudge against us for acting foolishly and sinning. Al natashet alenu chatat, asher no alnu v'asher chatanu. Which means he admits that we were crazy, that we were fools, that we spoke ill of you. אל נקתהי כמת, אשר בצאתו מרחם אמו, ויאכל חצי בשרו. Now Aaron, he's pleading Moshe for Miriam, for her health. Now when he realized that she became a leper, so he turns to Moshe. Moshe, maybe he can provide cure. So he says to him, let Miriam not be like a stillborn child, you know, like a baby who just was born, who comes from the womb with half its flesh rotted away. That's the description of a leper. Moshe did not say no, God forbid. He loved his sister and he loves his brother Aaron. Vayitzak Moshe el Hashem lemor. And Moshe cried out to God. And he said, El na refa na la. Five small words. God. Oh God. Please. That's na. Refa na la. Please heal her. That's all. That's all it took. And thank God. Well, Miriam had to be incarcerated outside the camp of Israel for 7 days, but all the nation did not move, waiting for her. That shows how much the nation honored Miriam and how important she was for everyone. But she was punished. That shows us that God does punish even the most righteous person. In fact, you'll be surprised to hear our sages say in the Talmud that God is extremely strict with those who are closest to him, the righteous people. Shehakadosh Baruch Hu medakdek im atzadikim afilu kechut ha-sa'ara. God is so strict with them, I mean like they almost do nothing, and yet if it is just a little bit negative in what they did, immediately they are punished in a severe way. Now you might ask, is this fair? Apparently a righteous person, the closest you are to God, maybe you should get the benefit of that. Imagine when you are the friend of the king, you are the closest to him. Can you think that he would be so strict against him? That's his friend. Well, God is not any king. He's not like a human king. He's the king of kings. And he says, the closest you are to me, the more careful you have to be, because you are close to the divine presence, the smallest sin will have to be paid dearly. And that's what we say about Miriam. Miriam was very close to God because she is very righteous, and therefore she should have been more careful. One of the reasons why God is very strict with the righteous is because he loves them. So he wants them to be even closer to him. To be closer to him, you have to be totally clean from anything, even just a small possibility of anything that can be considered a sin only by the righteous, not even considered a sin by a normal person. And yet, he wants them to be closer to him. Closer to him is, you have to be completely removed of any contamination. And sin, even the smallest sin, is a kind of contamination. So he cannot get close to God, but he wants them to be close. So therefore, he punishes them. That's one explanation. If you think about it, it's quite logical. After the 7 days for the leprosy of Miriam, the Jewish people finally left and they continue in their voyage throughout the wilderness for 38 years before they entered the land of Canaan. I just would like to tell you one word about the prayer of Moshe. What was the prayer again of Moshe? For his sister Miriam, El Na Refana La. O God, please heal her. The word please appears there with the word na. Na means please. But the word na appears twice in that little sentence. El na, God, please. Refa na, cure her. Cure her, please. Refanala. The Kabbalists say that this is one way how to make sure that your prayer will be granted. If you use the term na again twice, there is almost a certitude that your prayer will be accepted. I don't know how much can it be valid what I just said, but that's what the Kabbalists say. And we see it, we learn it from Moshe, who used this guy. He didn't even mention the name of his sister. Usually when people come to us to bless them, so we mention, let's say someone is sick. So you say to him, Mi sheberach avotenu hakdoshim v'torim, the Almighty God, may he bless you, and he provide you with a cure. And then you mention the name of the sick person. Let's say Shim, but you mentioned his name and then the name of his mother. The Talmud says that, by the way, when you pray for someone for healing, you have to bring also the name of his mother, because the mother is the body of the person. The father is the soul, but the body itself, that's the mother. She is the one who gave birth to him. So that's why we mention his name, the sick man, and also the name of his mother. And it's fun. But apparently the Kabbalists say that if you use the short sentence, sometimes it's better. But that's the custom. What we do is when we give a blessing, we mention the name of the father, of the man himself who has to be healed, as well as the name of his mother. There is a story that I would like to read for you. There is a story that's just quite interesting. It was a big rabbi, and he saw a friend of his who was also a very big rabbi. The second rabbi who came to the first, I forgot the names, and I can't find the page. So he said to him, Rabbi, please help me because I need healing. I need refuah. He was sick and he wants the rabbi to bless him. The rabbi blessed him. And then the other rabbi told him the name of his mother as well as his name. Let's say Shimon ben Sarah, for example. So the rabbi says, why would you want to use the name? Don't we see in the Parashah of Beha'alotcha that Moshe cured his sister Miriam without mentioning her name? Her name is Miriam. We didn't say Miriam Bat Chana, for example, or Bat Yocheved. Yocheved is the mother of Miriam and Moshe. We know that. So Moshe did not use this the names at all. He says El Narifanala, and that's all. Please, God, cure her. So the other rabbi said, Rabbi, but I know that it's important to mention the names, because you see, if you look at the numerical value all of Refanala or Refanala, you will find, I mean, in those two, three words, Refanala, the numerical value is exactly that amount brings to mind the name Miriam. The name Miriam, what is the numerical value? The Gematria of Miriam, Mem is 40, Resh is 200, that's 240. Then you have Yud, which is 10, that's 250. And then again you have the last Mem of Miriam, and that means another 40, so you have 290. But you add to it also the name of her mother, Yocheved. What is the numerical value of Yocheved? So we have Yud, that's 10, and Vav, that's 6, that's 16. Then Kaf is 20, so together that's 36. And then you have Bet, that's 2, that means 38. And then you have Dalet, that's 38 and 2, that's 42. So now 42 plus 290, you have exactly the same words of Refana. Refana, which the words that Moshe used to cure his sister Miriam. So Refa, Resh is 200, Pe is 80, that's 280, plus Aleph, that's 1, so 281, Lah, that's 35, Lamed is 30 and He is 5, so 35 plus, how much did we say? So altogether you have the number, the numerical value of Miriam plus her mother. So automatically we have here a wonderful source that teaches us that when you give a bracha to somebody who's sick, it's also very important to mention his name and the name of his mother. As I have explained, the mother is the body. But some people would use the same way that Moshe Rabbeinu has used, a very short sentence without mentioning any name, just Refael na Refana la, and it is extremely useful. But perhaps it requires some kind of thinking that is kept only for the meritorious, for the people who know what they are doing. All right, so with this I say to you, Shabbat Shalom, my friends, and all the best.